Andrew, you? Okay, great. And I'll invite our next speaker, Tod Machover, who is a composer and an inventor, is the Muriel Cooper Professor of Music and Media at the MIT Media Lab, and the Academic Head of Media Arts and Sciences and Director of Media Lab's Opera of the Future Group. And he'll talk about music.
Thank you. So music is a huge field, and myself and my group cover a lot of different aspects of music. So I wanted to just talk about one specific thing today, which is that I think in music, it's quite possible that generative AI is most promising in allowing us to find new things rather than to copy old things. So as it happens, maybe you know this, but there is a huge amount of generative AI music systems out there right now. It's pretty surprising. Companies get started every day. All the big companies are working in this area. And these systems are pretty good at doing a lot of things. They can generate music in the symbolic domain for things like notes and sequences. They can work in the audio domain. They can take text prompts. They can run live, so they can work in concerts. And they can allow for new kinds of input controls. But there are a lot of things, and actually, all of these systems, there are a surprising number of them, but I think that the results so far show that they're pretty good at sort of copying existing music, which means it gets quite close, but it's disturbingly not quite right. And they're also quite good at generating a lot of sounds and a lot of music that it feels kind of random, doesn't feel like it's connected or very meaningful. So what's missing? Why is that the case? And I think that most of the things that really matter in music, the structure, why and how music works, emotion, why music makes us feel certain things, how performance and interpretation work, how music adapts to particular situations and over time, and how music changes in different cultures, and simply the fact that there's so many different kinds of music out there, none of the systems so far really attack these issues. So I think it's really important to work on what we're calling musical common sense. There are various people working on this, but our group takes this very seriously. How do we capture exactly those kind of essential elements of music that I was just talking about so these systems know more about what music is and why it matters? And how can we use these systems to discover things not that are random, nor are they exactly the same as what we just did, but they're in a sweet spot where they're close enough to what we are looking for, that we enjoy them, but they're different enough that they make us think in a really different way. And there are a variety of ways of approaching this subject. We, in particular, do a lot of single-shot communication, looking at individual parameters of music separately, in addition to looking at how all the parameters fit together. We think of these systems as instruments rather than just as disembodied programs, which allow for a kind of constraint and definition of what they do and don't do, and also allow the entire human, including the body, to participate. We tend to generate smaller bespoke systems where we make the models ourselves. We can customize exactly what's in them and how they react rather than using large foundation models. And unlike a lot of the systems out there, we really like to work with the best musicians around to get really profound intuitions about how music works, and then afterwards to generalize these for everybody else. So let me just give you a few examples of ways of thinking about how these systems might work. The first are systems that react. So this is a system that we built over this last year, designed by Manasvi Mishra, a PhD student at the Media Lab. And this system takes in whatever a performer will play. You can navigate through a latent space so that the result of the system can be very close to what the person played or very different. You'll hear in this short example something where it starts a bit far away and ends up quite close to what's being played. So here's an example of a reactive system.
Thank you.
The next model is a system that allows somebody to explore. And this is a model that, again, we built ourselves. I created all the sounds that went in there. And then we created spaces where somebody could find out what's in there without, it's a huge space, so you can't be sure. But also, depending on how you use the space has a kind of magnets that allow it to emphasize certain things. So in this case, Nina Masuelli, who's just graduated from MIT as a researcher in our group, designed something called the jar, which is an interface with lots of sensors inside for position, motion, and touch. And it allows her to move in this space to find different things and to little by little discover human voice inside this space. So this comes from an opera of mine that we performed at MIT a couple of months ago. Another idea is extrapolation, which is to take a point of sound or a point of something you recognize and to have a systematic way of stretching it, of navigating it, of moving away from it, in particular, moving towards something else. So this is a project being designed by Nikhil Singh and Manuel Cherup, also at the Media Lab. They're presenting a paper on this at the NeurIPS workshop next month. And what they did is developed a generative AI system that creates a model in a virtual synthesizer, like an analog synthesizer with knobs. And you give it a text input. You can tell it to imitate anything you want. And it doesn't just produce that audio. It actually produces the settings on the synthesizer needed to create that audio. And once you've done that and have that model, you can say, OK, I've started with this. I want it to morph into this, and it'll actually change the dials on the virtual synthesizer to create the new sound. So in this example, they gave it the prompt of bird tweeting, fed it into the system, and you get a few birds to choose from. Pick the bird you like, and then ask the bird to morph into a chainsaw. Again, put it into the system. Pretty good. You can morph it into a helicopter, but I'll spare you what that sounds like. But the interesting thing about this is that the model was created automatically. Once you have this ability to interpolate, you can first of all study how one sound transforms into another, how psychoacoustically we process an image of one sound and another. And you have a space where you can navigate between sounds in a very broad way and use that musically and study it psychologically. And the last example is an idea of extending. And this is something that really interests me, the idea of creating a piece of music that has a form which is carefully crafted exactly the way you want it in every detail, but can also exist in a form that plays back differently every time you hear it, to surprise you, to delight you, and simply to stay fresh and interesting all the time. So I'm working on a piece right now which involves a river that I found in Vermont. Beautiful river, perfect sound, very complex. So I went up and spent a couple of days recording the river. That's my little fuzzy recorder and my boot in the middle. And I also recorded a string orchestra playing sounds that I wrote, imitating the river, made a huge database of both of these. And we're developing a system at the Media Lab called AI Radio. The project's called Flow Symphony. AI Radio, the idea is to have a piece like this that either automatically or by changing the dials can play out shorter, play out all day, reveal new things each time. In this case, reveal the changing sounds of a river and unexpected things emerging from the river. So this is just a little sketch, 40 seconds, of the piece that's starting. I haven't played it to anybody else yet, so you're the first to hear it. There's no visuals for this, so you might want to close your eyes for 40 seconds and maybe concentrate on the river sound and see what emerges from that. Awesome, a lot of you had your eyes closed. That's great. So just as the last point, we use all of these tools to create a large series of projects that we call city symphonies. And the idea for these symphonies is to go into a city, to make a large sonic portrait of that place using music, but also using the sounds of that place by listening to the city. And we ask everybody who lives there to collaborate with our team to create these projects. So we've done these in many places around the world, and we're currently working on a city symphony in Dubai. We're starting one here in the Boston area, and we're working on one about the future of well-being, actually, that connects places on all continents, actually, except for Antarctica so far. It's really exciting because these projects allow people of any age to participate, any background in music, lots to none, allow any kind of music or sound to be incorporated, from country to pretty wild, I would say. And the goal, the underlying goal, is to allow these projects with these new kind of tools to unleash and inspire creativity in everybody and to build community on a very large scale through collaborative music making. And so I invite you to stay tuned to all of this, both figuratively and literally, because I think there's a promise with generative AI tools to open up a potential for discovering truly new sounds in a way that can be very beneficial to individuals and to societies as well. So thanks a lot.